Hi. Good morning.
Can you hear it? Good morning. It is sort of good morning.
Yeah. For researchers, it is good morning. And welcome to NUPI. My name is Francesca Jensenius. I'm a senior research fellow here at NUPI, and I have the pleasure of inviting you and welcoming you to NUPI and to this first seminar in our new seminar series about inclusion, representation, and empowerment. This is part of now a new initiative where we're trying to get more focus on gender at NUPI, both through a project we have called Balance, which is co-financed by the Norwegian Research Council and NUPI, where we are have several measures to try to help senior female researchers on the path to professorship, since a lot of female researchers are underrepresented at the highest echelons of research, and also get more focus on gender in international relations and the work, the research we do here. Also, we have a new research project here at NUPI about legal regimes and the economic agency of women, which will be a comparative study on economic agency of women across the world. So what we're trying to do in this seminar series, and what we will start with today, is to focus on and present research, current research, ongoing research on gender, on women, on minorities, on empowerment of different kinds. And we're really happy to have three excellent scholars here today to introduce and present their work, their three recent books. And we're excited to see what they have to say about them. With me, I also have Øyvind Skorge as a co-moderator, who is finishing up his PhD on gender and politics from LSE, and is moving now to Norway and will become a senior research fellow at the Institute for Social Research starting in fall. So we will have this conversation with our authors together, and I'll give the word to Øyvind to introduce our first speaker. What we'll do here is first to let the speakers present their work, and then we'll have a round of questions from us and a round of questions from all of you. And so we hope it'll be a good conversation.
Yes. So it's a great honor for me to introduce Torild Skard, but when you're introducing Torild Skard, it's like, where to start? Because she has done so much. But I wanted to mention teacher, educator, psychologist, associate professor, member of the Oslo City Council, MP, the Parliament's first female president of the Norwegian Upper House, first director for the status of women at UNESCO, Assistant Secretary General at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Regional Director for West and Central Africa at UNICEF, Senior Researcher at NUPI, Head of the Norwegian Association for Women's Rights, and many other positions. In addition to that, she has also authored a lot of books since the 1960s, and most recently the book that she is going to talk about here, which is called Women in Power, Half a Century of Female Presidents and Prime Ministers Worldwide. And I want to mention another thing as well. So when you discuss gender research with people from Norway and other places, you often hear people discussing, have you looked at Torild Skard's work? She's already researched this question. You should definitely have a look at her work. So I don't know how much is left after she's done some work, but here she is, and she's going to present her latest book. Thank you.
Hello. I'm very happy to be back at NUPI, and the book I'm going to talk about actually was written here. So, it's like coming back and showing you what came out of it, because after I was here, I was translated into English, and now it's both in Norwegian and English, and I'm going six times a year to the UN Center of Staff Training in Torino to educate the high staff in the UN about the work that has been, in fact, done here. I have not much time, so I have to be brief, but I'm still trying to give you some main points and perspectives. And the overheads that you will see, you will can get copies of them after the seminar, so that you don't have to draw like a crazy to kind of get the points with you. You can get them. But what I'm going to say, you'll only get what's on the overheads. So I'm going to start going a little bit back in time and just remind ourselves that throughout the ages, women have been queens, emperors, chiefs, regents. And today we see also in different ethnic groups, particularly along the West Africa and in Southeast Asia, that women have higher leadership positions than we were used to in our history in the Western part of the world. It was a real fascination to be in West Africa and follow the traditional roles of women and men there. But we had a phenomenon called colonialism, where some Western powers occupied most of the world in the 16th and 19th centuries. The point I want to make here is that those people came from patriarchal societies, societies where men dominated and where power, status, and resources were allocated to men because they were men and women were subordinate. And the colonial powers eventually created nation states and political administrations and systems that then reflected the thinking and the traditions that they came from. We saw practically all over the world you would find different types of discrimination of women. Not as much everywhere, but very many places in relation to education and civil life, paid labor, and national politics. So, when in 1945 the United Nations was created to create a new international organization in San Francisco, it was mainly a male-dominated affair. There were 50 states there, and there were 3% women representatives. There were 3,500 representatives in all, and most came from Latin American Western countries. I mean, the war was still not over, so not everybody can come rushing along. And among the 50 states, there were 30 that had suffrage for women. There were also possibilities, because this was in the United States, to have NGO observers. And there were a number of NGO observers, particularly from the American continent, which was the easiest, and not least among from Latin America. I can't resist showing you a picture of the Norwegian delegation, where there was one woman, and she was, by chance, my mother. And she joined the delegation because there were women in London, where the exile government was, who demanded that there be at least one woman in the Norwegian delegation. And so my mother was already a refugee in the United States, so it wasn't too costly to bring her into the delegation. And so she traveled to San Francisco and joined in. But in spite of the fact that you had this very great majority of men, the Charter of the United Nations stated that we reaffirm faith in the equal rights of men and women and promote respect for human rights and fundamental freedoms for all without distinction as to race, sex, language, and religion. Now, the reason why that came into the text had to do with very active lobbying, not least from Latin American women. And if you'd like to read more about it, you could look at Forum for Development Studies, issue number 1 in 2008, where I have an excellent article about what really happened. And it was not what the official story is, so it was something else. The main thing was that you had in the Western Hemisphere, Latin America and Western countries, forerunners in the first feminist wave. And Norway was, among others, inspired by forerunners in America. And among these, you had Bertha Lutz, who was the leader of the Brazilian women and who was a very active actor in San Francisco. She was from Brazil. There were also actors from Dominican Republic, Mexico, Uruguay, and Venezuela who lobbied and who managed then to get the references to women into the text. The UN has a little bit different story, but I can't tell you that one now, except you give me more time later. What also was very important, I think, with San Francisco is that the American president had prepared this conference very carefully, FDR Roosevelt. He had really worked to have this a conference based on human rights, fundamental freedoms, and democracy. And after he died, his wife, who already was a very active activist and speaker and writer, she became the representative of the U.S. in the UN, and she chaired the meet in the Commission of Human Rights and made sure that women also were given human rights. Now, after the Second World War, the world changed. The colonies gained independence, and the number of states increased in the course of two decades three times. I mean, there were 50 states in San Francisco. Now we have 193. So, and very much of that increase, not all, but very much came in the war years after the Second World War with the decolonization. And with the decolonization, very many countries, more countries also got democratic political systems. There was also an industrial revolution going on, particularly in the Western countries, but also in other parts of the world, with rising living standards, spread of health and education. And this also mostly gained the industrial countries. But where it was done, it also gained women, though not as much as men. However, during these years, with so much emphasis on political development and economic and social development, it was very striking that there were very few women who got political power, who were members of parliament or of government. I can't guarantee for the expressions on the faces of these people, but I like the drawing. Then we got the second feminist wave, which was an extremely important event. It started in the United States and much of the Western world. You got new feminist organizations, a new consciousness raising, demonstrations, and the agenda was broadened to include sexuality, family, workplace, economy, and political power. And because it was the movement was so strong in very strong and active democratic countries who were active also in the UN, we got really a milestone in 1975, the International Women's Year. I mean, the United Nations, they had earlier reaffirmed equal rights of women and men, but they had not been that active. So in the women's movement, and it was the women's movement who then pushed forward, and then the UN, through the Commission on the Status of Women, up into the General Assembly, decided to make the International Women's Year. And in that year, they also had the first international global conference on women. The women's movement had asked for it after the First World War. They'd asked for it after the Second World War, but didn't get it. They got it in 1975 in Mexico with the slogan, equality, development, and peace. And when I've used this image of the logic of the logo, it's because very many things happened. It was really like, you know, a flood of activities. And they also decided to have an international women's decade, which then came afterwards. What I would like to particularly underline now is that at the big conference of Mexico, which was I was in the UN General Assembly in the fall of 1974, and I was amazed. There were only men. And when I came to Mexico in 1975, I was amazed. There were only women, or nearly. So it was really, it was the first time so many men, they represented their governments, yes, but so many women actually then came together. And what I want to maintain as some of the most important decisions was that they acknowledge that women of the entire world receive or have received unequal treatment. That was not known or accepted before. Now it was accepted. Doesn't mean just as much everywhere, but it was a global phenomenon. It was not just something curious, a little bit here and there. And they all agreed to the fact that all obstacles which stand in the way of enjoyment by women and men, women of equal status with men, must be eliminated. I mean, you read that. and it went to the General Assembly, and everybody voted for, huh? All the governments, excuse me, they voted for, 1975. And at, in Mexico, there were 133 states, with 5,000 government representatives. And they adopted a big action plan, and this UN decade. And then the UN did something that was extremely important. In addition to the government conference in Mexico, they had an NGO forum. And there, 6,000 women met. And what the UN actually was doing was supporting the build-up of an international women's movement, which meant that women could get together across the borders in a way they had never done before. And one of the most important results of the decade was the Convention Against Discrimination of Women, the CEDAW. And there were a lot of institutions were created, legislation was changed, research was started, and so on and so forth. But I can only mention the most important, and the most important is this convention. And a convention is not only adopted in a nice meeting in New York, you have to take it home, and you have to present it to your decision-making bodies, and it's now actually adopted by 189 states. They have said yes to the Convention Against Discrimination of Women. And they have committed themselves to, among others, pursue by all appropriate means and without delay a policy of eliminating discrimination of women and assure the full development and advancement of women. Not even Norway follows up that, and many other countries don't either. But it's there. Everybody has accepted it. And I think one of the important things is to remember. I mean, actually, everybody agreed upon that, huh? And then we had other conferences, and we had institutions and meetings and so on and so forth. But if I should mention two documents that I think are the most important to hold in your hand today when you try to do something for women, that is the CEDAW and then the Action Plan of Beijing. Because the Action Plan of Beijing was kind of the sum of very much of what had been discussed and researched and so on before. And it was the largest of all the conferences, 189 states, 6,000 government members, and 4,000 NGO members at the government meeting, 30,000 at the NGO meeting. I mean, there's not only political reasons for not having a new international conference. Actually, there's something about size, but that we don't have to go into now. But the important thing was governments and other actors commit themselves to take measures to ensure women's equal access to and full participation in power structures and decision making. I mean, there's nothing wrong with the ambitions. And the Sustainable Development Goals last year, they had adopted a special goal for women. And in addition to integrating women's concerns in other goals, and confirmed, for ensure women's full and effective participation and equal opportunities for leadership at all levels in decision-making, political, economic, and public life. And I was in New York now in connection with the Commission on the Status of Women, and we had a preparatory meeting, and all the speakers say, we have three demands. Implement, implement, implement. That's where we are. And what does this look like? After having worked for this since 1945, we only have 22% women MPs and 18% women ministers worldwide. And if you look at the top leaders, there at a certain point in 2015, it changes a bit, there were 7%. So, if we look at this, at the graph, you can see how slow the progress goes. And the red is the targets that the UN has adopted and everybody has agreed upon. They have all agreed that in 1995, you should have 30% women in all the decision-making bodies. In the year 2000, you should have 50%. So there's something about why we don't reach our own goals. And you see also, if you note in the bottom, you see the iron law of power. The more power, the fewer women. 22% is in parliament, which has less power than the cabinets, where it's 18%, and has less power than the top leaders with 7%. So there is something here, which is very interesting, and which is the question, why is progress so slow? There's evidently nothing wrong with the goals. I can't go into all depth with this, but I'll mention a few things. We got the first global research on the status of women in the 1980s. And it noted that in the world, women did 2/3 of the work, they got 1/10 of the revenue, and they had 1/100 of the wealth. So the picture was that women were burdened by responsibility, and men rode high on power. And that was the first time we got a global analysis of the relationship between women and men. And the years after, we have seen expanding capitalism, financial crisis, and growing inequalities. So in 2015, UN Women says, the world is wealthier and more unequal than ever since the Second World War. Only half of the women are in the labor force, while 3/4 of the men are. When women have jobs, they earn 24% less than men, and they carry the burden of unpaid care work. That's UN Women. Now, what are the problems? One problem is that especially privileged people in our systems, social systems of structure and power hierarchies, especially the privileged, resist to change. First, there's a tradition. I mean, you don't like change. But then there's also that some have something to lose and others have something to gain. And that makes a difference. And then when I've traveled abroad and talked to the UN, I've discovered that I have to remind them of very important research that Norway has done, where it has to do with hersketeknikker, the dominance techniques, that actually there are ways where those who have privileges try to maintain them in relation to those who haven't. And for example, they can withhold information, conceal realities and making invisible. We say in Norway that we're an equal society, and it's not true. That is an example of concealing realities. Ridiculing, co-opting, heaping blame and putting to shame, damned if you do and damned if you don't, double bind, dividing and ruling, using and threatening to use violence. These are different techniques that take place in different contexts where those who have power, it can be men, it can also be white in relation to black. I mean, this has to do with power relations, not necessarily who occupies it, but very often men have the power and they therefore use it in relation to women. I've printed it out so you can see it better than on the slide over there. And there's a little bit problem with the language, because in Norwegian, we talk about hersketeknikker. In English, Berit says sometimes translated into master suppression techniques or dominant techniques, etc. So if you look at it, Google it, and you don't have difficulty finding it, I mean, just don't give up. and I also like more than Berit. She only wants 5. Well, in my experience, I've seen, for example, that co-opting has been extremely important, especially for women getting into political parties, where they then are co-opted. They are given the wonderful hug on the condition that they shut up. In spite of these resistances, we see that there are more women heads of state and government. And that was why I wrote my book, because, I mean, the line was going like that, and all of a sudden it was going up. And so my book is about 73 women in 53 countries trying to ask why, how, now with all this resistance and all these problems, how on earth did they manage? And I was wondering, did the women's movement succeed, or was it something else? Well. Here they are. I've updated it till 2015. And you can see that they're spread all over the world in different continents, except the Middle East and North Africa, and in the Pacific. Though the Pacific got one in 2016 in the Marshall Islands, but before that, they didn't have any. The first came in 1960, and if you look at the first countries, it was Ceylon, India, Israel, Argentina, and Central African Republic. And that, so it, this is something that's happened different places around the world. And then because we're going to talk especially about differences between regions here, I have made a special updated statistics where I've then, if you look to the right, those are the not the people, the countries. Huh? So in the industrial countries, half of the countries have or have had a woman head of state and government, while the developing countries, 26% have or have had. And there are different reasons for this, but there's a very clear difference in living standards. There's also a clear difference in political systems. And then you see within the developing countries, there are very great variations. I told you Arab countries and Pacific, they have no country there until 2015 had a woman head of state and government. But then you see the different regions. It varies a bit from one region to the other. If you look at the women themselves, they are, I would call them superwomen. I mean, they had good health, they had good education, and they had the job experience. And it's very interesting that getting education is not only a way of getting knowledge, but they also to get to know other people. So I was looking, you know, thinking of poor women and things like that. Well, they first come into secondary education, they meet some well, more well-off man, and off they go. So the education is not only knowledge, it's also social relations and climbing up the social ladders. If you look at them, here you have the, you see the very clear, there were none from 1945 to 60. And then from 1990, that's where it starts going up. And that's when I started being curious. And wondered what was happening. And there you see the red are the industrial countries, the blue are the developing countries. There it looks like they're the same number. In absolute numbers, they are the same number. But remember that there are twice as many developing countries as there are industrial countries. So therefore, the percentages are very different. But at least this evident change from the 1990s, I think, is worth noting. And I think it, among others, has to do with this, the increasing number of democracies. I mean, the wall fell, and all of a sudden you got many more states. The whole Eastern Europe became many more states. And then many more of the countries became more emergent or established democracies. The red are the democracies. The green are the anocracies. And the black line are the autocracies. I won't go into the definitions because they're a bit complicated. But the point is the red one, that there is a very marked increase in democratic countries. And when I looked at my women, I saw that very, very many of them also rose to the top power in political democratic systems. But democracy and democracy and democracy, it makes a little bit a difference of what kind of democracy. Because, for example, where you have both a president and a prime minister, the women have a chance to get one of those jobs. If you only have a president or only a prime minister, it's a little bit more difficult. And also, it's easier in parliamentary systems than in presidential systems. And it's also easier in systems with proportional elections than with majority elections. So, I mean, there are many things you have to look at in connection with the political system. And also, usually, I look at them, they are surrounded by men. I mean, if you think of the numbers of women in parliament and cabinet and so on and so forth, I mean, there's only one that I really remember who came to power and who presented her cabinet, Michelle Bachelet, when she came to being president in 2006, and she put the floodlights on. There's one man, one woman, one man, one woman, one man, 50-50. But there are not very many 50-50s. Very often, the women were surrounded by men, and the question is how co-opted were they and how much freedom did they have to push women's issues? And actually, I was rather, having been in the political life myself in this country, I was a little bit skeptical. I thought, you know, they haven't had much chance. But when I looked at how they came to power, then I saw that some were substitutes. That is, that they came in the place of a dead husband or a father. But that's only in Asia and in Latin America that that has happened. And it doesn't mean that they got free ride. And actually, they had, nevertheless, to become leader of a party and fight for elections and things. So some were substitutes, some were outsiders who didn't weren't in politics before, but who, like Vigdis Finnbogadottir, or who was in doing other things, and all of a sudden, for different reasons, they needed a woman. But most of them, the great majority, rose within the political parties. And I must say, I'm very worried about the political parties, how they work, what's really going on, and there's very little research. And what we know that UNDP has given us, among others, that if you look globally, there's only 10% of the leadership of the political powers worldwide that are women. So how are we going to get women up if we all have these the glass roofs? They're not going to have roofs, they're layers of men. Excuse me. So the political parties, I really think we should study. And it's extremely important also that you have an active women's movement who asks for women in politics. Otherwise, it won't happen. I mean, those who are there are satisfied being there, and why should they bring in somebody else? But women have to ask for it. And even Margaret Thatcher, who became known for her anti-feminism, she wouldn't have got her job without the women's movement. The women's movement requested that there should be women in politics in the UK. The Labour Party got Barbara Castle. The Conservatives, oh, we have to have one too, you know, and that's when Margaret Thatcher got her chance. So the importance, it's very clear that it's extremely important that somebody, the women's movement above all, requests there should be women in politics. And then I looked at the women leaders, and I was a bit wondering. Nearly none of them were feminists, you know, and then that word, I think, has a lot of connotations, so they wouldn't say that. But when you look at what they did, and what I did was I took the CEDAW, and I looked, did they do something to promote CEDAW in words or in actions? I couldn't always see the results, but I took the CEDAW. And then you could see that there were some who just didn't care, and who even weakened women's position, and I called them conforming. One of five were conforming. Then you had the great majority were the compromising. You know, they did a little bit for men and a little bit for women. They didn't say too much, but they did something for girls' education or got some women in here and so on and so forth. Most of them did that. I mean, Merkel is a very clear example. And then you have some, and the number has been increasing, who were very clear that they were elected as women and wanted to do something for women. Pinta Silgo in Portugal, for example, is an example of that. Bachelet, for example. And so one of three would I see challenging. And if you look at the compromising and the challenging together, you get a good majority that could have done more. But this, nevertheless, did something. So it has generally made a difference if there was a woman there or not. And so the question is, how much difference? Now, do I have 5 more minutes? Okay. Then I just, from my experience, I just want to put some reminders of what we have to remember if we want really to make progress. And this is, when I'm speaking for the leaders in the UN system, this is what I then give them as my little points to go home with. First, they have to remember the international instruments. I mean, the CEDAW and the Beijing platform. I mean, the platform, if you don't have it, you must load it down and read it. There's a lot of good material there. And we must keep those who committed themselves to what they committed themselves to. So just don't forget it. Remember the instruments we have and make goals and strategies and action plans on the basis of those instruments. Even here in Norway, they're kind of forgetting the CEDAW and hiding it somewhere and presenting laws that are in direct contradiction with CEDAW. I mean, really, I'm very upset. And then we don't have enough research. We need knowledge, studies, analysis about different issues and contexts. We need sex-aggregated data. I mean, you can't fight the cause of gender. What's that? You need a gender perspective, yes. But you fight the cause of either women or men, because they are the two groups that have different positions. And you need to know, what does it look like? I mean, Hege Skjeie made a large study of Norwegian equality, and she came out with our equality policy was a failure, because men dominated in the economic world, in the political world, in the social world, in the media world. So we need studies to know where we are. And I miss the consciousness raising from the 70s. I really do. when we sat down and looked at ourselves and looked and said, well, what is all this gender thing about? What does it mean to be a woman or be a man? What is patriarchy? What is discrimination? And it's very interesting in the courses that I have in Torino. After I started there, they have also added another part of the course which they call to see the unseen. And where they put the group together and they start with themselves and to see what's going on. What does it mean to be a woman or to be a man, and how do we deal with it? And I think then it's important to see that we need institutional and legislative change in the political structure, in the electoral system, in the work and organization of work, in the care arrangement, in the recruitment to the political parties, in the quotas. I mean, there are a lot of things that have to change if we want the world to become more equal with regards to women and men. 128 countries have started different kinds of quotas. But quotas and quotas and quotas, huh? That can be so many things. We'll come back to that, I think. And then, as I've mentioned before, we need somebody who knows and who pushes. Women's rights champions and organizations, gender units, women's networks. They have to support and develop analysis and strategies. And it's good to have a critical mass, but it's not something that happens by itself. I mean, you can have a critical mass of people who don't care and a critical mass of people who care. I mean, numbers are important, but it's not the whole story. And then I think it is important to remember that we are two parties in this, and we wouldn't get the right to vote if the men hadn't accepted it. So we have to bring our men along so that we are together with the decision, implementing the decisions and the goals. Implement, implement, implement. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for a wonderful overview of, I guess, both the history of the entry of women into politics. And I really like the to-do list or the takeaway points of what to bring forward. It's really a pleasure to welcome our second speaker today, Marla Htun, who is a professor of political science at the University of New Mexico. Marla holds a PhD in political science from Harvard. Has also worked at New School, is now at the University of New Mexico. She's one of 32 scholars who have been selected to receive the prestigious Andre Carnegie Fellowship and is currently a holder on that. The reason why she's able to be here and in Norway for a while, we're really happy to have her here. She's also a collaborator on our new project here at NUPI, so we hope to be able to get her to come here more often. Marla really has an amazing list of publications. She's written extensively on quotas, on disadvantaged groups, on inclusion of women and minorities. Her work was one of the main inspirations for me when I started my PhD on minority quotas. And what she'll present on today is her most recent book, which is on inclusion without representation in Latin America. So please.
Good morning, all of you. Thank you so much for coming. It's really a pleasure to be here in Oslo. I'm incredibly grateful to Francesca for collaborating with me and for inviting me to be here on this panel, to Øyvind for co-moderating the panel, as well as to my fellow panelists, Torild and Elin, for participating. But I'm going to be talking a bit about my recent book, which was just published in January of this year, Inclusion Without Representation in Latin America, Gender Quotas and Ethnic Reservations. Now, this book tries to make sense of a phenomenon that Torild just flagged in her presentation, which is the global embrace of gender quotas and other mechanisms to try to reach some of the international and domestic goals for women's participation in decision-making and public life. My book is trying to make sense of this phenomenon. I'm asking, why were these mechanisms adopted? What do they look like? How have they worked? Have they worked? And what some of their consequences have been, both for the presence of women in politics, the representation or advocacy of feminist interests, as well as for deeper questions of democracy and social justice. Now, I'll tell my own personal story that I have always been a bit skeptical of some of the international organizations and feminist claims that these quotas would be a fast track to achieve gender equality. I started out in the mid-1990s as a consultant for the Inter-American Dialogue and Inter-American Development Bank, just at the same time that many Latin American countries were adopting gender quota laws, and as international organizations were creating high-level groups of women to meet periodically and develop an agenda. So I sat in these meetings with ministers, senators, former presidents, elected officials from different countries. I sat in these meetings in the mid-90s and I watched them fight. I watched them fight over what was the point of bringing women together, over whether women had common interests, whether the duty of women in power was to advance those interests or not. And some women said, well, absolutely it is. If we're not advocating feminism, what's the point of us being here? And another woman said, well, I think that that's totally silly. If there are dictators, we want to have women dictators too. So they were all quite different and diverse. And I think on the basis of that experience, which happened when I was still in graduate school, I always was a bit more circumspect about the idea that somehow women's presence in power would serve to advance a common agenda, as well as to generate conditions for policy change toward gender equality. So that made me skeptical, and so I've been working actually on this book for many years. I mean, some of the interviews that you'll see cited in this book are from the late 90s. A lot of the work I did is working papers for these international organizations. But the book is not just about gender. It's also about the experience of Afro-descendants and indigenous peoples in Latin America and their struggles for inclusion, the adoption of some policies to get them into politics, and the results of those policies. Now, I wrote a big paper on this in 2004 when I discovered that systematically across electoral democracies, women got candidate quotas in parties, whereas ethnic and racial groups, when they got mechanisms for inclusion, they got reserved seats in parliament. So there was a systematic difference between the types of policies states were adopting for women on the one hand and for ethnic groups on the other. But this doesn't hold in Latin America, because unlike in sort of former British colonies, where the state historically imposed a regime of strict racial classification, Latin American states were much looser. They didn't count groups by race or ethnicity. Boundaries were much more fluid and ambiguous. So what does it mean in that historical context for the state to say, well, I want to reserve two seats in parliament for Black Colombians? It means something very different. And so I wanted to explore that a bit too. So I'm going to proceed today. I can't possibly summarize the entire book. So I'm just going to tell you three arguments or stories that I make in the book, and then I'll conclude. All right. So the first argument is about the inclusion but not representation, that quotas and reserved seats deliver one but not the other. The second argument is about the payoffs of intersectionality. And then the third argument I'll make is about the outcomes, or what happens, looking specifically at the case of Argentina, when women enter the legislature in a massive number. I don't have that many slides, so I'm going to keep it here for a while. So the first argument, inclusion but not representation. So I make a very strong theoretical distinction between inclusion, which I define as the mere presence of members of excluded groups in positions of power, and representation, which I define as an activity. So a process, an activity of actually advocating or acting on behalf of someone else's interests. And I argue that quotas and reserved seats, so candidate quotas in parties and reserved seats in parliaments, deliver one but not the other. What is more, the way that quotas and reserved seats were applied in Latin America, they sometimes preclude the activity of representation. So I work a bit with Hannah Pitkin's classic book on representation, and she says that representation, the concept of representation is like going into, and she wrote this in the, you know, in the 60s, right? So it's like going into a dark room, and there's a very convoluted statue in the middle of the dark room. And you have a flash bulb, so not an iPhone, but one of these old flash bulb cameras. And you take pictures of this convoluted object from different angles. And each one of those pictures is a theory of representation. Or that's how theories of representation have evolved, is that it's just one dimension of actually a quite convoluted object. But eventually in that book, Pitkin settles on a substantive theory of representation. She finally says that it really has to mean acting. It has to mean behavior. Acting on behalf of somebody else who is the represented. Now, formally, democratic theorists have taken this a step further, as well as Pitkin did, by saying that representation requires a constituency. And that is a group of people that could be defined formally or informally that authorizes a representative to act on behalf of their interests and then holds this representative accountable at election time. Now, whereas inclusion merely requires the presence of a social group, right? Some member of that group in power, representation requires a constituency. A constituency in a formal electoral democracy is usually, in the US anyway, defined by a geographical district, right? So in the US House of Representatives, or in the Indian lower house, there is a single member district geographically determined that elects that representative to the Congress, and then so they authorize them and then hold them accountable. Now, in a PR system, as many other countries, the constituency is the political party. So the constituency self-forms at election time. Now, my argument, which is a bit technical, my argument is that quotas and reserved seats neither create formal constituencies or informal ones. So in Latin America, it is not constituencies of women who elect the beneficiaries of gender quotas. Rather, it's the male-dominated political parties that Torild spoke of who pick the women to fill the quota. And these women are accountable both to their handlers, who are the male party elites, or to the party electorate as a whole. They're not accountable to constituencies of women. Right? Not at all. Nor are the constituencies informal. So an informal constituency could be a social movement that self-authorizes itself to act as a constituency and holds the representative accountable more informally. But these mechanisms in Latin America have in fact sowed greater divisions among social movements. Okay, so let me show you my blockbuster slide. So how perverse this is that in the 2014 Colombian elections, these were the two individuals who won the seats reserved for Afro-Colombian movements. Neither one of them was recognized as black by sort of black rights social movements. But they're still elected because the law doesn't say you have to be black to win the seat. How could it? Nobody really knows, or there's a lot of contestation about what black is. It's not like in the US where the law of racial integrity, for example, in Virginia, said that everybody who has one drop of Afro-descendant blood is black. No, nowhere in Latin America has that kind of rule. And so, you know, it's all about recognition. And neither one of these two individuals, even though they won the Afro-descendant seats, were recognized as black because they're not elected by people who are self-declaring themselves to be black or even people who are geographically organized to be black. Rather, they're elected nationwide. There's no mechanism to define constituencies by race or ethnicity. And with regard to gender, the state deliberately chooses not to. So we can talk about this, you know, as we say in English, until the cows go home. But this is the substance, more or less, of the first argument, that these mechanisms deliver inclusion, but they don't deliver representation. And in some cases, they may, in fact, preclude representation. Because, of course, this created a scandal and lots of fighting among all of the Afro-Colombian movements who had fought for these mechanisms in the first place. Now, so the second point I want to make is about the payoffs of an intersectional approach. Now, intersectionality is a perspective on social difference, which holds that, you know, we are not just women, but we are simultaneously white and brown, lesbian, straight, disabled, fully functional on most days, foreign, domestic, whatever, that we are simultaneously the holder of multiple identities, and that big social structures of difference and domination simultaneously position us at the intersection of these categories and identities. So this intersectional perspective implies that women is not just a homogeneous group or a homogeneous category, but rather a collection of categories. Black women, white women, lesbian women, disabled women, rich women, poor women, etc. And moreover, that these categories can have opposed interests. So when I was promoted to full professor, it was women who were opposing me, right? Three women voting against me for me to be promoted to full professor. I know you're looking, you're like, huh, yes, yes. Nancy Fraser is now, you know, making the argument that the feminism of the Sheryl Sandbergs, the Anne-Marie Slaughters, and even the Hillary Clintons is a feminism built on the backs of poor women to whom they outsource their domestic labor. So women are quite diverse, and women have different interests. So what does this mean? Well, so I kind of operationalize this by unpacking the diversity of women as an explanatory device, and made the argument in one chapter of the book that where we see quotas in Latin America and where we see quotas where women from the parties of the right and the left were able to overcome their differences and form a coalition against the men to demand these quotas. But they didn't everywhere. So in the case of Chile, for many years, women of the right parties and the left parties had irreconcilable differences. They couldn't agree on quotas. And we didn't see them. Didn't see them approved. And so I have a quote here from a Mexican senator from the right-wing party that I'll just read. So let me just read this quote. So this is Cecilia Romero, who's a senator from the PAN party. She said, "The demand for quotas came about because party leaders failed to respond to our demands for participation. It doesn't matter if we like the quota. It's a necessary measure. Without a quota, things would take too long. Some women are enthusiastic about the quota. Others simply recognize that there isn't any other way. It should be a temporary thing." And so these women from the right-wing party, they don't like it, right? They don't like any kind of group rights. They kind of held their nose. Experience convinced them that the men were, you know, not going to come around to promoting them. And so they kind of held their nose and said, okay, well, we're just going to do this, but we don't like it. And so I find it really interesting that they're finally willing to admit that. They don't like it, and they're saying it has to be a temporary thing. They don't want it to be a permanent group right. So the other example of this intersection, the payoff of this intersectionality comes from the case of Bolivia, which is also a chapter in this book, where a graduate student co-author and I try to explain why Bolivia, under the regime of so-called indigenous president Evo Morales, adopted a gender parity regime, but only a very small number of reserved seats for indigenous people. And so we say this is a puzzle, because this is, you know, the celebrated indigenous rights regime, and yet they were very chintzy, giving only 7 seats in a Congress of like 160 seats to indigenous Ailus. But they gave, you know, they agreed to gender parity, or at least the attempt at gender parity. So why? So we describe a process in which, also after years of trying, women from the largely sort of white, urban, feminist movement came together with indigenous women, whom they had little connection with in the past, to demand this quota. But the setting, and it was also a situation where the indigenous women, historically, had not been willing to develop a project with the white women at all. Their alliances were always with the indigenous group because they saw the main issue as being, you know, decolonization against the white state, etc. But so I'm going to read you another quote from a female deputy. "The movement towards socialism, which is the hegemonic party led by Evo Morales, is not exactly linked to a feminist movement or a recognition of gender. It is an indigenous project that hasn't really looked at gender issues. As a result, it's difficult for a parliamentary group dominated by men to understand our issues, and even more to see them as real problems. I'll give you an example from a congressional debate on the proposed law on gender-based political assault." So this is a law against basically the intimidation of women elected officials, forcing them to resign their positions so that the male suplente or the alternate could take their place. It had already largely been discussed and approved. But when we were in the process of approving it, one of my male colleagues turned to me and asked, why we hate men so much. Right? Laughing, it sounds familiar. But so given that climate, also the indigenous women realized that they had some common ground with the white women and joined together in this project for the quotas. But otherwise, due to their intersectional differences, they were more interested in being with the sort of sexist, with the sexist indigenous men. So my final point here on the outcomes of quotas. So another co-authored paper, and this is the last substantive chapter in the book, with a couple of colleagues, we wanted to see what happened in Congress after women entered massively as a result of the quota. So Argentina was the first country in Latin America and one of the first in the world to adopt a legislative gender quota. And you can see over time, so this is a graph of women in the Argentine Congress, and the Senate adopted the quota later, implemented the quota later only in the early 2000s. The House did so for the first time in 1993. But you can see that it had quite a dramatic effect. Right? I mean, women's numbers really went up. I mean, this quota worked. It was a closed list system. There was a placement mandate. The quota really worked. So the question is, what happened to legislative activity? So he had this amazing data set of all of the bills presented, as well as the fate of the bills in the Argentine Congress. And so we coded them to see what bills dealt at all with, you know, women and women's issues. And we found that over time, there was a rise in general legislative productivity. I say productivity because, you know, a lot of these are pork. They're not really necessarily sort of productive national public goods policy issues. But the rate of growth of bills related, this is a crude, like, electronic coding, but the rate of growth of bills related to women grew at an even faster rate, okay? So, but we, you know, controlled for a bunch of things and found, and this is where we're trying to look at Jenny Mansbridge's. So Jenny Mansbridge has these arguments about representation, that when you want to evaluate the quality of representation, the unit of analysis should be Parliament as a whole. That is, we want to see what the behavior of everybody in Parliament is, like, not just women. And so a lot of this growth is men, right? So women's presence is not just associated or creating conditions for women to present more women-related bills, but also the men are, because they see it's politically profitable, because they're socialized, whatever. And so we see in this one that, yes, the rate at which, or the prediction at which, this is the level of women's presence in the Congress, how many women-related bills this legislature, a female legislature or male legislature, is likely to submit increases for women, but it also increases for men. So women's presence has an effect on male behavior. At the same time, though, we found that the likelihood that any one of these bills would actually be approved declined. Okay, so they were being presented, maybe discussed, but they weren't being approved. And so we interpret this as some evidence of support for theories of legislative marginalization, right? That there is, you know, sort of a cartel that is running Congress, and that it takes a lot. Like, you can get into, you know, a committee, you can get into a party, but it takes a lot to actually break into the central power structures. And there are lots of theories of this is why, and narratives that Jennifer Piscopo, Ilan, and my colleagues have gathered say that, you know, the women are complaining that the men want to have meetings late night in the bars. I've even heard a story of the party list in the city of Buenos Aires being constructed in a strip club late at night. You know, so these kinds of conditions are not, you know, they're gender specific. Anyway, so let's just wrap up now. So given, what's the point of presence and what's the point of quotas? Now, in my study, Laurel Weldon and I have been working for a long time also, and we have a draft book manuscript now where we're trying to understand policy changes toward gender equality. So looking across 70 countries over, you know, a few decades of time, we find that women's presence in Parliament is really only weakly associated with progressive or egalitarian legislation. It's usually significant in a multivariate regression. It's usually a significant variable, but it's very weak. So, you know, 10 percentage point growth doesn't really mean a lot substantively. So I don't think that having women in power, and I haven't seen, that it leads to massive policy revolution. It takes a lot more than that, right? But what does it do? Well, and Nancy Fraser is again relevant here, because I think that what it does is it helps erode society's status hierarchies. So the status hierarchy is an institutionalized pattern of cultural value that casts some groups as normative or important or worthy or valuable, and other groups as less so, marginal, other, less worthy of rights. And having people who are brown or female or gay in a position of national leadership, they may behave exactly in the same corrupt way, but at least symbolically, you start to associate those features with more value. And there is some, you know, psychological evidence for this, and some studies on the Obama effect, right? Which we can also talk about later. So I think that the importance is really to erode stereotypes and the status hierarchies. And this is just one slide from a meeting, the 4th Regional Conference of Afro-Descendant Women in the summer in Costa Rica. I think it was 2013. And so we're in the Sala de Expresidentes in the Costa Rican Parliament, where all the portraits on the walls are white men, all the former presidents in these sort of gilded portraits on the wall. And yet the meeting is all sort of black women and a few black men. And at one point, I can't remember which one she is, I think it's her, the former minister for racial equality in Brazil kind of stood up and she said, you know, we're here and our project is to get some women on the walls of these legislative chambers, you know, and that's what it is. It's just presence. Thank you very much.
We have not only, can it does yeah, we have not only two but three excellent speakers today. The last one is Elin Bjarnegård from Uppsala University, where she earned her PhD in 2010. She is now an associate professor in political science, and she's also associated with the Department of Peace and Conflict Research. And I think that very much sums up some of our work, which not only covers political science, electoral laws, political recruitment, and so forth, but also conflict and peace and women's role and the attitudes associated with conflict and peace. So she's very much covering a very broad field and from a gender lens, and she's been doing field work in Thailand, Maldives, Tanzania, Bangladesh, and so forth. And she's now going to talk. We're very lucky to have her here to talk about her book, which is called Gender Informal Institutions and Political Recruitment, Understanding Male Dominance in Parliamentary Representation, which I think will very well complement the two perspectives we've heard so far. Please welcome Elin Bjarnegård.
So is it on? Yes, it is. Good. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you all for coming. I'm really honored to be here, and it's very exciting to stand here and speak after these two people that are two people whose work I really admire. So I'm really happy, and it's a bit of a challenge to stand here and talk after the two of you. Anyway, what I'm going to talk about is actually not women in politics. I'm going to talk about men in politics today. And this is, you know, for a lot of reasons. First of all, it's what my book is about. But it's also, I'm going to talk about the book today, but it also is kind of the perspective that I've tried to have in a lot of my research that looks at different arenas, not just the political arena, but also looking at violent conflict and looking at other spectrums of the political sphere. So although I will base the talk on the theoretical arguments I make in my book, this is also something that I've worked on in a number of other ways. But it's also because I think this is kind of part, and I think that this rings very true after listening to the two former speakers as well, that we see this problem, and we've seen it for a long time. If you talk to women in politics, we see the problem of the male-dominated parties, we talk about the barriers, but still, so much of the gender and politics literature is about women. And the difference of women, and what can women make a difference? How can they make a difference? The successful cases. So I still really think that without really acknowledging it, gender and politics is focusing on gender, equaling it with women, when gender really is, of course, as much about men as it is about women. And the other thing is that I think that if we look even broader, the whole field of political science, or even social science, if you will, is really, you know, looking at men without explicitly acknowledging that they're looking at men. When we look at power, we still analyze male-dominated parliaments, councils, meetings, without really naming the participants as men. So I think this is something that's also, you know, a challenge for the broader field to acknowledge and to recognize that power is gendered and that power still lies with men, and trying to understand the same thing that we've heard before, but also from a different perspective. How can men stay in power despite all these influences, despite all these wonderful programs and ideas we have? How have they managed to cling on to power? And what are the mechanisms and the motivations for doing that? Let's see. So in my view, the kind of like thing that got me started, I had worked on with gender and politics in different ways for a long time, but several years ago now, I first encountered the statement that women are less corrupt than men are. And I almost laughed when I heard it. It seemed very strange to me that this would be something that would lie in the sex of a person. But gradually I realized that it actually gained attention and it gained influence. And the World Bank started producing reports saying that we need more women in parliament so that they can curb corruption. And you saw different arguments coming up that bring in women. They will help us solve corruption, but also increasingly you saw that you could bring in women and we would get peace and we would get all kinds of good things would come from the inclusion of women. And what this particular statement builds on are correlations, statistical correlations, showing that countries who have more women in parliament also tend to be less corrupt. And this correlation, of course, can be interpreted in a number of ways. And to me, the most evident way is not saying that the very few women that we are still talking about have somehow managed to solve the big national problem of corruption and implement it at that. As we know, implementation is a tricky thing, right? So the other way of looking at this would, of course, be to say, well, what's specific about the corrupt countries that enable the participation of men, the continued participation of men, and that creates barriers for women to enter politics? If we look at political parties in these countries, what conditions the selection of candidates? Who is selected and why? And what type of networks do you need to be a part of to get access? What are the opportunities for people who are not part of these networks in these countries? And how are these issues gendered, if we start looking at this? So instead of using the inclusion of women in a very instrumental way, asking what do we get if women are included, we very rarely ask that question of men. We could also ask, you know, what is it that hinders women in certain contexts, and how can we understand where women are included and why they're not by looking at these networks and the informal arrangements that may facilitate for men. And although I have looked at corruption, I think this is something that you can talk about informal networks. We have them in every country in the world. So although, of course, there's a difference in degree, I think the kind of looking at these informal understandings and what networks you're part of and how that creates access is something that is perhaps very explicit in certain contexts, but certainly rings true in a lot of other contexts as well, although you may have to look a bit closer to see it. So, looking then at corruption and masculinity really brings me back to the points I started off, that if we look at what difference do women make, in what way are women different, we are not really, you know, looking at men as gendered beings. Gender does not equal women. So when we see that countries with a large proportion of men are more corrupt than others. That also tells us something about the construction of masculinity in relation to corruption and what corruption is. So instead of just focusing on the difference of women, can we problematize the gendered practices of men in this context? And maybe we need to stop expecting women to solve male-dominated problems and look instead at the fewer opportunities that certain contexts create for women. So I totally agree that when we look at political power, political parties need to be in focus. We need to look at the gatekeepers, the people who select candidates, and try to understand how they select candidates. Why? What criteria are they using, formally and informally? And how does that help us understand the patterns that we see globally in terms of who gets access to power? One theoretical perspective that has really helped me understanding these issues is feminist institutionalism. It's really looking at both formal institutions and informal institutions. So recognizing that rules and norm systems structure political lives and behavior of political actors, but it's not just formal institutions. So it's not just electoral systems and the laws that political parties themselves set up or the criteria for candidates that they set up. It's also about rules of the game that are, you know, shared understandings about how to behave, shared understandings of what you need to do in order to be seen as a suitable candidate. So Helmke and Levitsky have defined informal institutions or saying that many rules of the game that structure political life are informal, created, communicated, and enforced outside of officially sanctioned channels. And what feminist institutionalism has brought to this is the realization that many of these practices and the consequences of informal institutions are gendered. So they have gendered consequences. It may not be that they're conspiracies, that people are thinking that, okay, we are really going to keep women out. Sometimes that's certainly the case. Especially recently, I've worked with election violence and gendered forms of election violence, and I very clearly see that sometimes that's exactly what it's about. Women should not be here, and they're saying that straight out. But many times, it's not about that. It's about doing what you've always done, trying to stay in power, which is really what politics is about, making connections to people who can help you to stay in power, and not just realizing or caring about that that has gendered effects about who gets into power. what I will do now is to briefly outline the case study that my book builds on. My book is from 2013, so not really that new. It came out in paperback last year, so at least it's affordable now. And it focuses on Thailand, but as I said, the same kind of framework has been used by me and others as well for other studies of political parties as well. So the big question I ask here is, how does one become a member of a clientelist network? And I'll get back to what clientelism is very soon. And who is invited to these networks and why? And the overarching question is understanding that these networks are key to electoral success. They are the networks you need to be a member of in order to be selected by the political parties. So this builds on a statistical analysis on 400 elections worldwide. I'm not going into that very much. I'm going to focus on the case studies of these networks and the candidate selection practices in two parties in five constituencies in Thailand. So of course, this is Thailand pre-coup. Right now, it's a military dictatorship, and you can't really study the workings of the political parties anymore. So you need to keep that in mind. But it builds on the mapping of clientelist networks. So about 150 interviews where I tried to follow people who were the candidates and the people they worked with, both more locally as well as nationally, and understanding how do you select people to be in these networks and how does it matter for getting into parliament ultimately. So these networks then. Clientelism, for those of you who do not know it, is kind of, it's it's a very typical form of informal institution in the sense that it's not written anywhere. You won't find any documents outlining that candidates should behave in a clientelistic manner. But nevertheless, when you talk to people, everyone knows exactly what they're supposed to do to gain votes. And this is about exchanging services for political support. And services can range from vote buying, so directly paying someone for their vote, to bringing pork constituency services to the people who support you politically. And this is really, in many parts of the world, a political logic that's completely a shared understanding of what a politician is supposed to do. It's considered to be a fair exchange. And it's something that's absolutely needed in Thailand and in many other places to get to parliament. You need to buy votes in either in the direct form or at least to demonstrate how you bring services to the people who support you. As I said, they're not written, they're known to insiders. So when you speak to people, they can tell you very elaborately exactly what they do, how they do it. If you read party documents, they won't tell you anything about what's really going on. And this also means that if you go to Thailand or many other places and try to understand how parties select candidates and you look at their formal criteria, they will not get you very far in understanding what's really at stake when parties sit down in karaoke bars and strip clubs and other places to make the important decision about who is going to become a candidate. There's no application procedure. Their members are handpicked of these networks. And these networks, demonstrating that you have supporters all the way down to the village level and all the way up, are absolute key to electoral success and to being selected by the political party. There are many elaborate ways that I can get into later of, you know, trying to assess the amount of clientelist support that you have before you select a candidate and before the election. And another very important thing with these networks is that they are strongly male dominated. In the 150 interviews I did in my mapping exercise, I asked the candidate, who did you help in a political career and who did you get help from? I was not once directed to a woman. In one place, I specifically asked for women and got to talk to a few, but when I spontaneously asked the politicians who helped them and who did they help, I was not once given the name of a woman. And the reason for this is what I am trying to get at in my book and in my research. And what I've come up with is something that I call homosocial capital. It's trying to understand how and why these men in these networks only select other men, how they reason about it, and why they think it's necessary. And this builds, as I see it, on two separate motivations. The first one is an instrumental motivation. They all say that it's necessary for them to build linkages to people with access to important resources in society. So if you're a politician, you need to build linkages to other politicians, perhaps at the local level, or to people with funds for infrastructure, for instance, or to people who have resources and power in society to make you yourself more influential. But it's also the expressive motivation, a kind of psychological desire to cooperate with individual whose behavior you think that you can understand and perceive and predict. And this is something that psychological research has shown is very gendered. Thinking that we can understand someone else and how they will act is something that we tend to do more with people of the same sex as us. So looking just a bit more closely at the instrumental motivational factors and how they work in the clientelist exchange. So when you're doing clientelist exchange, you really need a lot of resources. Sometimes you need money, but you also need to make promises that you can build roads or a well or a new school or whatever. And then you need the resources. You need access to people who can help you get those resources to be distributed in your networks. So you simply will not be able to win an election or even a nomination without having those linkages. And these people who sit on positions of local political power, who sit on infrastructure budgets, who have influence in different ways in the Thai context, as well as in many other contexts, are still men. So what these men are doing is not consciously building linkages to other men, they're building linkages to important people in important positions that happen to be men. One of them explains it like this. So people think that the national level politicians help the local level politician. Actually, local level politicians have helped national level politicians more than the other way around, because the local level politicians are closer to the people. So the clientelist candidates really need people who are in the village, who can go to villages, who can go to funerals and weddings, and who can be there and distribute money and be close to the people and also report back. So they really need the local politicians, and at least in Thailand, the local level is even more male-dominated than the national level. The national level had pre-coup about 10% women in parliament, the local level 3 to 4%. And the expressive motivational factors then. Especially, I mean, I think politics in general is a secretive business. You don't really want to let out your strategies. Clientelism, you know, even more so, because it's often bordering to the legal. You're certainly not supposed to buy votes. And you're not really supposed to give pork to that extent, as most people do either. So it's very, very important to achieve predictability, to feel that people that I work with, I can trust them. If the election commission comes here asking, I know what they will say. I know they won't talk to other people that I don't know. And as I said earlier, what we know about these expressive motivational factors is that we generally tend to perceive that we can predict the behavior of people of the same sex better. And we tend to see ourselves, when people talk about promising younger politicians, people I see myself in, that's also very sex-specific. It's a very strong identifying factor. So when male politicians say, I see myself in him, they very seldom say that of a woman, and vice versa. If we see potential and we think of ourselves as very competent, we tend to make that sex-specific as well. And this was the case in Thailand as well, when people said, well, I don't really know if I can trust her. I don't know who she will go talking to. I need to trust the people that I work with. So one person said, I am the leader of the village team. My team consists of people who have been my own canvassers in local elections. There were more people who supported me, but I had to look at the honesty. I don't turn away the rest of the people who are just there to learn secrets. I just give them some other task and don't make them part of my team. So you have to work with people who you trust. And candidates, unless I ask them, didn't really talk about the gender of this a lot. But it was more the fact that when they talked about the people they trusted, they always tended to be men. And when I talked to the few women, they trusted the women. But one candidate that I really kind of tried to press on this said, well, women think with a mentality that men can help them. They can talk and tell men what needs to be done, and the men will do more than the women. If you have a good friend who is a man, you will feel better than if you have a woman friend. You are more comfortable when you work with other men. So the consequence of this really is that the way that society is structured now, men can build all male networks because they need to build linkages to important people in society, mostly men, and they also need to work with people they trust, also men. So they have all male networks and they can usually find those two qualities in the same people. Whereas the women I talked to still needed to find the resources. They also had to build linkages to the resourceful people and the influential people in society. But the people they trusted weren't necessarily the same. So their networks were mixed, and they were much less stable and strong. I guess the good thing about both these aspects is that they can change. So it's not, you know, if and when more people come into power, the instrumental resources will be available also for women, And if and when more women come to power, there will also be more people that you can link up with and trust. And perhaps it will also teach us that trust does not have to be gender specific. But the way it is now, just to conclude, I think that understanding gender inequalities in politics requires understanding how men maintain power, both the very open discrimination practices, but also the unconscious practices that they do to stay in power and that have unintended gendered consequences. And I think that homosocial capital, which is then a political resource that's presently available only to men, is often essential for different types of network building, for access to political parties, and ultimately for electoral success. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So can I invite the panelists to come and sit up front so that we can have some questions? We have about half an hour left, and I'm sure there are many questions. So we thought we'd start with a couple, and then we'll open up for a few questions, and then we'll have the chance to have a bit of a conversation. And I must just say, I was very excited to hear all of the presentations. I think this is an example of a lot of the very exciting research going on, which is moving beyond what was for a long time the state of the art, which was really about looking at number of women in different political positions. I think all of these books are taking a huge next step in thinking about these issues in a different way. And I think my two questions is first of all, since we're a foreign policy and international relations institute, gender equality is in some ways a commodity that Norway tries to export in many settings. We care about promoting gender equality in other settings. From what your research shows, you're talking about networks, candidate nominations, parties, and perhaps that promoting quotas may not be the most efficient tool for promoting gender equality in other settings. So I'm curious about your perspective on, you know, what should the Scandinavian countries and other and agencies do to promote gender equality in other parts of the world? And my second question is, since we're many young researchers here who will be continue to be interested in working on issues, what do you see as the most promising research agendas for the future? And even you.
Yes. So yeah, just to continue a bit on the gender quota question is. So is there a trade-off then between women having or women's interests being represented or implemented into policy and gender quotas, so that if you implement gender quotas, you will get a lot of women, but you won't necessarily get the policy that you wish? So is there a trade-off, or can the two go hand in hand? Can they break down male networks and so forth? And the second question is, so in Torild's book, there is a mentioning of the women in powerful position having often being married to men who are professionals or who take more responsibility at home. So I wonder about the vision of labor at home, whether you can elaborate a little bit on how that plays into to women's entrance into power. Yeah. Yes, should we?
Was just really a follow-up on your first question, because I'm not sure if I have the numbers right, but I think that in the last report of Interparliamentarian Union, they compared the representation in Parliament between 1st of January 1995 and 1st of January 2015, and they had a top 10 list. And in 1995, Norway was on number 2. And on the 2015 list, we were not on the top 10. So it was just in relation to that we sometimes talk about women representation as a challenge outside. And then we sometimes also forget that the issue about gender equality and representation is an issue that we also need to focus on.
We can open up for another question if anyone else has. Yeah.
Um, I was wondering how it came about using the intersectional approach in your book, and how if you've used it before, and how it helped your research.
Can we take another one, or is that enough for you guys? Sure. You want? We can open up for another one if someone wants.
I was very intrigued by one statement that you made, and if you could elaborate, which is that colonialism arose out of a patriarchal structure. And that would be very interesting if you could just elaborate a little bit on that.
Thank you. Then I think we'll give each of you some time to respond to these. And also, if you want to comment on anything in the other presentations, you're of course welcome to do so. So, Torild, do you want to go first?
To take the last question first, I didn't say colonialism was a result of patriarchal structure. I mean, I might think so, but I mean, research doesn't really, there isn't enough research to really say that, because we don't have anything to compare with. Huh? But what I was important was that those societies that actually became colonial powers and went to other countries and then established a domination and new states and administrations and political systems came from patriarchal societies and therefore took with them that type of models and ideas about how things should be. So, I mean, for example, in West African countries that I know very well, you can find women in very high positions in the traditional communities. And then the modern nation state parliament and so on and so forth, you find the Western pattern male domination. So I think that's about as far as I dare go there. Now, I saw one who was very knowledgeable about West Africa. She's unfortunately gone, but somebody could have commented. Oh, but I think we need to study more. And regarding quotas, I just would like to note that quotas are very many things. And for example, the way quotas have been used in Norway, I mean, it means because we have a proportional election system, that means that you put women on a list, and these lists are then presented to electors in the same way as with both women and men. And then in local elections, as you know, voters can then push women up and down. So then the whole relationship to the constituency becomes something different. I think it's very important to look at how, and that I think was very exciting, that we getting so specific about what this is and how it works. I think that was very interesting. Regarding the Nordic countries, I would like to say that I remember Heidi Holted in the 70s. She analyzed the Nordic countries, and she said, well, you must be careful, because the society will become more complicated. It will be more difficult to see what's going on, and therefore it also things will be hidden, and it will be more difficult therefore also to change things. And I feel very much that this whole question of hiding realities has become so frequent in Norwegian society. I mean, the word likestilling, what on earth does it mean? I don't scarcely use it anymore, because it means everything and nothing. And in many cases, it means equal treatment, period. Well, was that what we were talking about? And, you know, Hege Skjeie, with her great reports showing that Norwegian equality policy was a failure, where are those reports? Who's reading them? Who's using them? They disappeared. There was an election and they're kind of gone. And I feel that when I was all of a sudden confronted with the leadership in the UN organizations in Torino, I mean, the fact that somebody came from Norway and said, listen, we haven't reached the goals either. Oh, you haven't? And then they were extremely excited to learn about why we hadn't and what was it about, and to get a true picture. And if we want to advance, I think truth is a very good ally, that seeing what we have achieved, but also what we have not achieved, and others can learn from it. So instead of pretending that Norway, because we're relatively well, that we have reached the goal, I think that's a lie that we should not keep up. I think we should, it's very important to look at reality, and then we will share experiences with other countries who have achieved some things and not other things. I mean, go to Rwanda and ask how do the quotas work there, for example. I think if I want to leave some time for my colleagues, I think I give pass on to you.
I'll also take the last question first, which is the intersectional perspective. So, I mean, as many of you know, the term was first coined by African-American feminists in the U.S. who were skeptical of white feminism. And they said that, you know, the collective subject of feminism was, in fact, white middle-class urban feminists whose life experience, whose particular life experience gave rise to the problem that Betty Friedan called the problem that has no name. That is, I'm sitting at home, I'm bored, I'm not realizing myself with a career. And for these African-American feminists, they said, you know, what the hell is this? You know, I would love to sit at home and be bored. You know, I'm working my ass off, you know, single, supporting 5 kids, whatever. And so it came from that. But I think that, you know, for me personally, having encountered many women, especially in Latin America, you know, starting in the 90s, who were very skeptical of feminism and refusing to call themselves feminists, even as they were actually living quite a feminist life, perhaps on the backs of, you know, underpaid domestic workers. But so I think that for me, it really had to do with the diversity among women and the difficulty of an ex-ante project that kind of, an ex-ante meaning not a deliberated bottom-up work. I believe it is possible to have a women's project, but that everybody has to be involved in some kind of collective deliberation to develop and formulate that project. It can't be an ex-ante, like, okay, this is the feminist project, you know, take it or leave it. So for me, it came from, you know, reading that, taking it seriously, and then from my own experience. And I just want to say something about this sort of top 10 list. So I am, you know, one reason I wrote this book and have gone into this business is that I've always been extremely skeptical of women's presence in politics as a measure of gender equality. I mean, if you look at the top 10 list now, I mean, number one is Rwanda. And I think that just shows you how shallow and meaningless the list is, right? Because if Rwanda is number one and Norway isn't even in the top 10, I mean, come on, what kind of measure of equality is this? And I think that over time, international organizations are seeing this less and less as a measure of equality. In the 90s, you know, the UNDP Gender Equality Index, this was one of the top three. I mean, this was what got you as a gender empowerment measure, right? This was what got you into the rankings as a gender equal country, was how many women were in parliament. And now I think over time, there's a lot more skepticism to see its limitations, to realize that many countries have done this to look good abroad without making the serious structural changes. So what does it take to make those changes? Well, if I were to pick between, you know, growing your economy and expanding the service sector and quotas, I would say grow your economy and expand the service sector, so that women from the bottom up have access to resources. Because I think that gender equality comes about through, you know, bargaining and challenges and cultural change in the interstices of daily life, coupled with maybe some top-down leadership. But it really is a bottom-up phenomenon. I think that social movements, so is there a trade-off between quotas and policy? Well, I have some work invested in the role of social movements and feminist movements as an important infrastructure to guide change and to provide resources to people on the bottom who want to produce positive change. And I think that without some kind of civic infrastructure of social movements to link leaders with the bottom up and to empower, you know, women with resources who want to make changes, it's going to be very hard. So we can. I'll also move on to be respectful of time. This is for all quite respectful of one. Is this a gendered panel? Yeah. A gendered mode of social
action? Possibly, yeah. Okay, where I'll start from the beginning then about exporting gender equality. I mean, that's of course very, very tricky. I think that one thing that I, when I work in with consultancies, and I talked just the other week to a group of women from Myanmar who were tasked with peace building in Myanmar, and they had been in Sweden for several weeks, and they had learned everything about all the wonderful, you know, treaties and documents and about their rights. And what I tried to do was actually bringing in Berit Ås and Härska Tekniker, and also talking about the fact that they are going to come back with all these new ideas, and they're going to sit in these male-dominated environments. And here again, we have educated women and we expect them to come back and make a change in situations where they have very little power. So I think one of the things we need to do also in practical work is to bring in the men there as well. But also I think that the suppression techniques or whatever we call them in English are very, you know, something that especially Norway can really export as useful tools for actually implementing these things. What happens when you're there and you're going to do the work? Because I think that's often what's missing from all these ideas that we at least quite easily can get people to agree with in principle. So yeah, just to really emphasize what has been said about quotas, I think I think that the big increase in literature and studies on quotas have really shown us that they're not a simple thing to understand. And there are different kinds of quotas that some of them may help to break male networks, especially perhaps the type of candidate quotas that are really asking candidate selectors to think about qualified women as well as qualified men. It's kind of a learning procedure for political parties. It could be. On the other hand, then do we not get the representation? I've also worked in a project showing that, you know, one of this we have known for a long time that one of the most common reasons that quotas are not effective is that they're simply not implemented. So again, we have these wonderful laws and parties just don't follow them. And what we have shown is that whereas more bureaucratized parties, so parties who actually follow their own regulations to a greater extent, while they implement the quota so they have as many candidates that they're supposed to have, they put them on the bottom of the list. So they're not more gender equal. They don't get women selected, even though they look good. And also, where are they implemented? In what types of countries? We know for a fact that socialist countries have been excellent at having quotas and making this part of their whole equality discourse. At the same time, parliaments in these countries are powerless. And I've just started a project now looking at kind of the semi-democracies, the electoral authoritarian democracies, trying to investigate how quotas are really used just to boost electoral power of the ruling party in these countries. And then, you know, it's, yes, we see an increase in women, but what does it really imply? So I think also going back to, you know, what is a fruitful ground for research, I think we have far from, you know, emptied the quota box. There's a lot to do there still. And of course, I think men in politics is also an area where we see an increase in research. And if you're interested, I have a network together with Rainbow Murray, and you can sign your name up here and I'll add you to the email list.
Wonderful. I think we can do another round on question if anyone has anything.
I forgot to say, first of all, that I think that the composition of the panel is excellent. Yeah, because we have all this different perspective on the issue, which is not so often. And for me, I work for the Oslo Center. I work with political parties, and I have worked with women in political parties in several countries. And a lot of what has been said, I think, is also my experience. Because when it comes to the quota, for instance, it's not necessarily just because you have a quota, but who appoints the persons to fill the place in the quota, which is also a big, big issue. And also the nomination process as one of the key barriers to get into position. So I thought it was very interesting to also have the political party dimension, and I think it's an area that needs to be worked in more, because I think it's, even though we have talked about inclusion and representation, I think that it's not just of being there, but also to play the role. I just worked in Nepal, and you had a constituent assembly of 601 members where you had more than 30% women. But when the group that was deciding on the constitution was only men. And I worked with women in political parties to make amendment list where some of those Berit Ås techniques were used, being threatened that you will derail the whole constitution process if you put forward amendments to secure more women rights, as one example. So it's just, I just want to confirm that this is very interesting, and I hope that both from my research and from a practical point of view, that more focus could be on political party and what role they can play.
Anyone else? I have another question, if I can go. I must say, I really appreciate the focus on men and the networks. And it resonates very much with my own research on India, where I've been working on the inclusion of minorities particularly, and also on women. And I think my conclusion there is really that Indian politics is structured in a way where not only most women are excluded, but most decent men are also excluded from politics because of clientelist networks, and you need a lot of money to get into politics. And I think that's quite symptomatic of a lot of the world. And so you're bringing in Norway here again, which I think is important, because although there are different levels of to which extent networks matter, I think networks are key in politics in most places. And I actually wanted to bring back to Tore's point of missing the consciousness raising groups from the 70s, because you wrote on this in the 70s on how to have groups and create more awareness around gender roles. And I must say my own feminism is very much raised on a father who was part of daddy groups in the 60s and 70s and the thinking around that. So I would love to hear your thoughts on both what can we do now in terms of that consciousness raising around networks and loyalties, and also what Torild was saying of what we want to get to. What is equality? What kind of equality are we interested in getting to? So since this was huge question, you can feel free to pick anything you want, and then I think that will be the concluding remarks from all of you, and I think probably all of them will be around afterwards if anyone wants to come and say anything afterwards too. So Torild.
Thinking of the debates I participate in the UN training. I mean, I've been kind of saying we must look at the political parties, but I mean, actually, we have to broaden it and look at the political life as a whole. Because, I mean, if you take an example that I know rather well, Liberia, I mean, you can look at the formal political parties, but nothing goes on without the informal clientelist networks. And everybody is in one or other informal clientelist network. And we can be very strict and say to Ellen Sirleaf Johnson, you must not be corrupt and whatever, whatever. But if she doesn't deal with those networks, she can't get anything done. So I think it's extremely important. And also, I'm very concerned about Norway. I mean, in the course of a few years, the membership in political parties, I mean, we're down to 6% of the population. Now, what are they doing? What are everybody else doing? And everything which has to do with education, political education of the people, who's taking care of that? So, I mean, I think the challenge really is to look at our, if we want something called democracy, what are we talking about? And how is it structured? And how do we manage? Democracy means government by the people. Now, how do we manage the relationship between the people and the government? And I think it's extremely important that we bring in women and men as a very important dimension, because what I discovered when I was writing my book was that also in science there was a kind of a divide. Either you talked about politics and democracy, but not women, or you talked about women. But there was nobody kind of seeing those things together. We must talk about democracy and then bring in women and men, because otherwise we'll be talking from very different perspectives. And then I think these techniques from Bezos are extremely important, because it's seeing what otherwise becomes unseen and understanding. For example, in Beijing in 1995, we fought to get gender mainstreaming. Why? Because we had isolated small women's projects and we wanted the question of women and men to be all over the place. What happened? The men power elite made it into gender male streaming, which meant that they locked down the women's groups and they made stronger men's groups, because now, and the women and the gender perspective disappeared, because now it was supposed to be not women and men, but gender. I mean, there's a power game going on all the time. And I think that's what we need to see and need to deal with and need to analyze. Thank you.
I want to go back to some of the earlier questions about, you know, Norway's promotion of gender equality and the most important questions. Is this on? The most important questions for a gender and politics agenda. And I'll just make two points. One is that something I'm really struck by, especially considering women's rights in the Global South countries, which I've, you know, worked on for a while, is the limits of state power and the weak institutionality. So we're talking a lot about policy and whether quotas can achieve policy change, but even if policy is beautiful, you know, and so well thought out and very feminist and very egalitarian, for example, like the gender violence law in Mexico that Francesca and I have worked on, practice is a totally different story. And even in a country like Mexico, which is relatively well institutionalized compared to Afghanistan, you know, there's a huge gap between the law to live a life free from violence and the kinds of everyday violence that women are subjected to. And the degree, not even how efficient and receptive the court system and the police are to their claims, but whether women themselves are willing to come forward with a claim of rights violation. And so I think that, you know, looking, so the next step for me anyway is to look sort of beyond policy and the architectural design of state action and to look at the conditions on the ground and, you know, the extent to which and the conditions under which those can be shaped. And the second thing that I think is really important is that I have the impression that gender equality today is really about gender equality among the rich, and that it's important to square the project of gender equality with other equality struggles. And in the US context, this is really about class equality. I mean, the escalation of income inequality in the US over the past five decades has really been astounding. And there is a division between gender equality practices and beliefs among the rich and among the poor. And that has consequences for the upbringing of children, the well-being of children, and the reproduction of social inequality over time. So there's a multiplier effect, and the situation is getting worse. In Europe, you know, the Equality Project is really about multiculturalism and the difference between a historic majority and different sort of ethnic and religious minorities that have different norms and practices. And so, you know, the extent to which equality struggles in these different spheres are related, I think, is important, and the extent to which that a thrust of equality from one sphere toward the other can actually be counterproductive. And I think that France is absolutely the best example of this. I mean, the national secular laws on Muslim women, I think, are having the absolute counterproductive effect toward the equality of Muslim women in their own communities. And I think it's because people often don't think of culture in the right way. People think of culture as kind of a homogeneous sealed box, but rather it's a field of contestation. You know, it's a battle for interpretation over what our culture is and who speaks on behalf of our culture. And often, in most of the world, the people who have spoken on behalf of culture are sort of old men. You know, it's rarely women or marginalized groups who speak on behalf of culture. And so creating the conditions in which, you know, women from these groups can be empowered to speak and to control the interpretation of their culture, I think is very important.
Okay, yes. a few things. I think one thing that we need to realize as we go forward is that I don't think we can get rid of informality. I think informality is always there and everywhere, and it needs to be. It's the way we interact as human beings. So we really just need to be aware of it and recognize it and being able to name it and try to evaluate when it has the wrong kind of consequences. I mean, we don't. None of us wants to live in a world where we only kind of like go by formal rules and don't interact as human beings with each other outside of the office. It's not about getting rid of it, but it's about understanding how it works and recognizing when it works in discriminatory ways. I think it's also very true that most men are excluded. So this is really an issue of intersectionality, and that's where that becomes so important, seeing who is privileged here. That sex is one major division, but it also, we need to look at it, as I said, it's the men with resources, and who are they? They're not any man in Thai societies or elsewhere. So that's a very important thing to remember. As for kind of the future, how to think about democracy, I think, you know, one thing, again, is bringing in the men also in discussions about gender equality, but also then demanding things from the men. I've done a study on the Social Democrats in Sweden on the reform of the parental leave system. And in at least in Sweden, every single politician in the Social Democratic Party is a feminist, and they're proud to say they're a feminist. And the thing is that when they decide at the final stage not to support this quite radical reform of completely individualizing the parental leave, no one shames them for it. Not a single person. So they get all the credit for being the feminist men who promoted in the beginning, and they don't get any kind of bad will for stepping down at the last minute. For the women, it's the complete opposite. You know, even whatever role they have, every other woman in the party will say, oh, she's a traitor, she doesn't stand up for this. And as we know, politics is about getting things done, so it's all often about compromises. So I think bringing the men in, but for real. And the real challenge, I think, is about how we lose young people in political parties. And I sometimes really don't see how we are going to get young people to get into politics. I was at an event in New York a few months back now, where women from the whole world were standing, women politicians standing, sharing their stories about harassment, about rape threats, about social media, how they are, out there being threatened and being sexualized. And I was just thinking, who would I ever recommend this career to? And that's a really, gendered gendered problem that we really need to find a way to deal with. I'm ending on that very depressing note, sorry.
Do you want to have an optimistic last word?
I was really fascinated by all your three presentations because I'm a journalist, and I found all your three presentations so nuanced and so real, because among other things, I did contest for India's parliamentary election. So I have some experience in that, and the real challenge, and I come from the most educated state, which is Kerala, and the reality was that women are terrified of coming into politics because it is a sphere of slander. So, I don't care because I'm much too old for all this kind of, nonsense that people would say. But what we found was, as you said earlier, that it was difficult to get good people, as you mentioned in your, it is the hardest thing is good people stay away from politics because it is so dirty. But what we found was that the youth was so easy to galvanize them. And before they get into these informal networks, we have to capture them into this right area. And I think in some sense, I see great hope even in United States, because Bernie Sanders' triumph, so to speak, that he got this far was because of the youth. So I think around the world, there is this, the youth is coming around to this, and we have to have the right leaders to inspire them, not the establishmentarians, because they have lost trust, I think. But I see a lot of hope. And what you said about the US and the class struggle, that's exactly what it is. Multiculturalism of Europe, India has all these problems. And I feel a right kind of combination of people inspiring the youth, and we can break all these networks. That's the only hope.
That at least was a more inspiring ending. Torild wanted the last comment.
I just wanted to say that when you talked about a meeting where they were talking about all the violence women politicians met, I was in another meeting where people were men were sharing experiences. How can we do it? How can we work together? How can we promote it? And where it was very clear on the one hand that we have to keep screaming aloud and raising our demands, and then we have to hold hands in different ways. And for example, when I told about my early days when things, I felt we managed to do something in the Norwegian parliament, I mean, one of the things we did was that the women from the different political parties, we got together in the ladies' room. In the ladies' room, we found out how we agreed and disagreed. And then we got strengths from each other. And then we went into the different parties and we managed to push several issues. So the question is, we have to find specific ways of working together in different contexts. And people are sharing points of view. and people are looking into how we can improve our techniques. So that's also a kind of technique. Huh?
Perfect. Thank you so much. Now I can only say thanks for being here. Please check out the books of these wonderful scholars, and we hope we'll have future debates as well. Thanks so much for being here, and I'm sure the panelists would be delighted to say hello if you want to say anything. Thanks.